Okay, hi guys. I am back with another video, and this time, the last time the video was on beta thalassemias basically, and this time, as promised, this is on cytopathology. The last video was a little long because beta thalassemias are a very big spectrum, and but this will be a very short discussion of cytopathology pediatric tumors. Why I have taken this topic is A, because I am moving according to Gray's and Orell's, so that I can cover all the chapters that are there and discuss with you all the pitfalls that you will face when you are reading these chapters. Secondly, I work in a pediatric setup, so I realize how difficult it is to diagnose a pediatric tumor and to differentiate between a benign and a malignant tumor. So keeping in mind, there's not much you can do morphologically on cytopathology. Lot of pediatric tumors is IHC and molecular. Be it in any part of the body, the pediatric tumors are very similar morphologically. So what I will help you, everyone knows about the IHC. I'll even tell you about the important IHCs and how to go about it. But what is more important is there's very, very subtle morphological clues that when you are looking at the slide, when you are looking at it from a practical point of view, then those morphological clues are going to help you in, maybe giving you a direction that yes, you are thinking ki if supposing you get a tumor and it is a small round blue cell tumor, and then you get a background of lymphoglandular bodies, and you're getting it, it is a vague lump in the abdomen, you're not sure it's a neuroblastoma or a lymphoma or it's a mediastinal mass. And if you get lymphoglandular bodies, then yes, you can be sure that this is a hematolymphoid lesion rather than a soft tissue lesion. Or if you get a tigeroid kind of a background in a mediastinal mass, although that is common in germ cell, but sometimes you get it in small round blue cell tumors also, in PNETs, etc. So, these are subtle hints and clues that are going to help you in, deciding what IHC panel to put in ICC, or even if you're advising the biopsy, at times it is not easy to differentiate what pediatric tumor it is. So, let's move on. So, this is a range of pediatric tumors, not neoplasms, that you come across when you're doing FNAC. I have put the four most important ones that you are going to be asked, that you are going to come across commonly, and that I have discussed also. And I'm going to make a part two where the rest remaining, the ones which are not in bold, I'm going to cover that in a part two. So this is basically a part one. And part one is mainly the small round blue cell tumors. Of course, I've taken others like spindle and rhabdoid tumors. But this is mainly hematolymphoid and soft tissue, with maybe some systemic tumors which morphologically mimic soft tissue and hematolymphoid. The second part would be again a very, very short one, where I'm going to take the tissue, the organ tumors, like kidney tumors, pancreatic tumors, germ cell tumors, the thoracic, like Hodgkin's lymphoma is covered in lymphomas and small, Hodgkin's is not actually small round blue cell tumor, or it is hematolymphoid, but the morphology is not small round blue. So, I'm going to be dividing it into a big chunk of what is small round blue, and then another chunk of not exactly system wise, because it's a mixture. You are getting a hematolymphoid in this part two also. But morphologically, it will not present as a small round blue cell tumor. In the end, I'm going to show you a red herring where we, made a mistake, and then we published that paper also. So let's move on. So the spectrum of small round blue cell tumor, if you go by the definition, is very easy also, because you'll just see small round blue cells and nothing else. You might see some molding, you might not see molding, you might see some neuroendocrine character to it, you might not see what is neuroendocrine character, that is that stippled nucleus, nuclear molding, etc. You might not see, some pleomorphism, you might not see. So you will ask me then, why am I discussing it? As I said, the best way to differentiate is by IHC or ICC, but most of time it is IHC we in India, at least in regular setups, don't do ICC. But what I want to discuss here are those subtle morphological hints that you get when you're looking at a slide, which gives you a direction as to which small round blue cell IHC you should apply. So rosetting, as you can see over here, these all are rosettes. All right, I don't know where my marker has gone. Oh, here it is. These are rosettes over here. So rosetting is common in tumors like, look, location is a very big hint. If it's a CNS tumor, you're going to think about medulloblastoma. Fine. If it is an abdominal mass on adrenals, you know, neuroblastoma. So, of course, location matters. But what if it is a mediastinal mass? It can be a spectrum of things, from germ cell to lymphomas to metastasis to extraskeletal PNETs. It can be anything. So we have to, you know, see the background. In small round blue cell tumor, I personally feel, this is my personal experience, that background is very important. So if you're getting a lot of neuropil or rosettes, then you are sure, apart from the location, then you are sure that this is maybe a neuroblastoma or a medulloblastoma. Then we have studied about types of rosettes, true rosettes and false rosettes, homerite and flexor intestinal rosettes. If it's a lesion in the eye, it is a retinoblastoma. Then if you are getting vague kind of rosetting, not very classical, it could be Ewing's. Ewing's has rosettes, classical as well as non-classical rosettes. Neuroblastoma can have neuropil and rosetting around it. People mistake glands, and this I'm not talking about pediatric tumors, with rosettes. You know, there's a big difference. We have studied it in MBBS also. That the rosette, the lining is outside. In the glands, it is inside. Always remember that. This is how we used to, you know, differentiate, because sometimes, even in adults, you have tumors with rosettes. So there you make this, ki ye glandular structure hai ki rosette hai. So rosette can have neuropil in the center or may not have neuropil in the center. So that is a very big differentiation between true and false. So a lining on the outside, it's not exactly a lining, but a collection of cells on the outside is a rosette. One, and when it is inside, it is a gland. It is as easy as that. So here I can show you all the rosettes, and then of course the background has all these small cells and this vague myxoid kind of a background. So you can make sure that this has to be neural, something neural and small round blue cell. You might get this uniform small round blue cell population with maybe occasional, you know, large cells. This is more like hematolymphoid. One very important thing that I look when I'm looking at hematolymphoid, maybe thinking about this, are these lymphoglandular bodies. They're very small in this picture, but they are lymphoglandular bodies. Lymphoglandular bodies will only come when it is a lymphoma. Another small cell lesion, not very common in children, but you can see in adults also, as those small cell lung carcinomas, if you do an FNAC, you're going to see this kind of a molding. Okay, this kind of a molded pattern where one nucleus is molding over the other. So these are, you know, subtle hints which may make you decide ki, okay, now this is the IHC I need to put in this case. So this is a very practical approach. This is there from Google Images, where you can decide how to go about it. If it is a tumor that comes to you from a vague location, where you're not sure that I have to, you know, where the radiology is not very helpful about the origin of the tumor, we have to start with first putting the epithelial markers. Then we divide ourselves into specific small round blue cell markers and soft tissue markers. Certain soft tissue markers, if they are not present, you are definite that this is not a small cell variant of a particular soft tissue tumor. And then you can move solely with the small round blue cell markers. However, if a soft tissue marker comes positive, which is quite common, then you have to, you know, apply a panel and, you know, differentiate what tumor it will be. So I can go about and say that you put pan-CK. Then if it is positive, you can go for soft tissue, because small round blue cell tumors are not commonly, I don't remember anyone which is positive for pan-CK. Soft tissue tumors are EMA, etc. Synovial sarcoma gives you that positivity. But then again, you will not get confused. You will not confuse a SS with a small round blue cell tumor. So, and of course, if I'm missing out something, you are free to please tell me on Messenger if I missed out, and I'm going to, you know, correct myself in the next lecture if I'm wrong, that if any soft tissue tumor has PAN-seq, I don't remember, any small round blue cell tumor. So if it is a Desmin SMA positive, DSRCT, desmoplastic small round blue cell tumor, is a small round blue cell tumor, yes, but it is like a overlap. It has a lot of sclerosed fibrocollagenous tissue and few scattered small round blue cell nests and streams. Yes, I'm sorry, this is one of those round blue cell tumors. But in pediatric cases, we don't think about DSRCT, just like that. So yes, you can say this is one which is a pancytokeratin positive, after that a Desmin positive. Negative, you go for lymphomas by using LCA, that is CD45 positive, then have to work in hematolymphoid direction. If it is negative, you go for an epithelial membrane antigen. Put S100 and HMB45, which is a melanoma. So one tumor which mimics anything in the world is a melanoma. It can mimic a spindle cell tumor, rhabdoid tumor, small round blue cell tumor, sometimes even an epithelial tumor. So melanoma should always be a DD. Okay, of course, then again, if all this is negative, you go for, if EMA, etc. is positive, then you can go for neuroendocrine markers also. And this has to, like CD45 negative, PAN-CK negative, EMA positive, S100 negative. Go for neuroendocrine markers and see whether they are positive or not. Then if melanoma markers are negative, you go for vimentin. Again, vimentin is also negative. Here vimentin was positive, Desmin vimentin, here it is negative. Think of neuroblastoma, CD99, etc. Then go for Desmin. Desmin positivity or now myo D1 positivity, rhabdomyosarcoma. Of course, neuroendocrine are always a differential for small round cell tumors, and PNETs and Ewing, CD99 is common marker. PAS is very important in Ewing sarcoma. Now, this is an old chart. I'm going to take the recent, I've taken it. Chick ducks for tumors and BCOR mutated tumors are newly added tumors in this category, which are based on the molecular classification. And we have missed so many tumors. We have categorized them as PNET or Ewing's before this molecular classification came out. But now molecular is the go-to for every tumor that we see, the soft tissue tumor. And we should not miss those tumors if molecular investigations are available. Okay. So see, please go ahead. You can read this in American Journal of Surgical Pathology. BCOR, CCNB3 fusion tumors. These are round cell sarcomas. You can read about them. Then even rhabdoid morphology tumors might mimic small cell tumors. They are small cell variants of certain rhabdoid tumors. So when you see a rhabdoid morphology, you can, at least I used to initially when I was a JR1, confuse it with a plasmacytoid morphology. But slowly you get a hang of what is plasmacytoid with a HOF and rhabdoid with an irregular pleomorphic kind of a nucleus and a cell, and a very well-formed eccentric nucleus with a HOF kind of, which is a plasma cell. But rhabdoid morphology tumors and epitheloid morphology tumors, I'm digressing from the topic, but these are also pediatric tumors. And INI1 loss is being recorded and reported as the INI1 deficient tumors have been given a separate category in small round blue cell tumors, in pediatric tumors, and they have prognostic implications. Similarly, as I said, Chick ducks 4 and BCOR mutated tumors. Again, a panel of markers. This is an old chart. You have to update yourself with what recent. SMARCB1 INI1 mutation, you can read this paper by Kohashi et al. This has been published in Cancer Science. There are many papers available. So last but not the least, hematolymphoid. You have to understand that in hematolymphoid lesion, there are a spectrum of lesions which are benign in the gray zone as well as malignant, which are small round blue cell. They might be accompanied with other hematolymphoid cells. They might not be accompanied with. In fact, the WHO hematolymphoid, which has updated itself, has included diseases like multicentric Castleman's disease and EBV infections, etc. EBV-induced lymphomas. Now, in the classification, even lymphomatoid papillomatosis and mycosis fungoides was there, but lymphomatoid papillomatosis and granulomatosis, etc., have been included in the WHO. Skin is a very hematolymphoid is a spectrum which some of you must have studied Castleman as benign initially, but it is not now. It has been included in malignancies now. So a lot of changing in hematolymphoid tumors, both pediatric and adult. And unfortunately, most of the small non-blue cell tumors you come across in pediatric are infiltrations by lymphomas or acute leukemias or a transformation of CML maybe into acute leukemia, something like that. Okay. Finally, the spindle morphology, you know, normally you get angiosarcomas, etc., but like synovial sarcomas, they have spindle morphology. Even sometimes rhabdo might have a spindle morphology. So there are a lot of overlaps which we, you know, need to think before we can decide and which IHC to be put. And that chart there is helpful for that, which I had shown. Again, this is the case that I wanted to show you. This is a paper which has been accepted in the journal or the journal, and it is by Juniper Publications. And this was a red herring for us. We received a child with a lesion on pinna, and we did an FNAC, and there were a lot of giant cells, few small non-blue cells, but a lot of giant cells, and we had repeated the FNAC multiple times. And I am not showing the images right now because it was under publication. Now the paper must be available online, so you can go ahead and see it. And we reported that lesion as a giant cell rich lesion in a pediatric two-month-old child. And we were thinking that this could be a cartilaginous lesion, because looking at it from grossly when I was doing the FNAC, a lot of that ossifying areas or it had that look of a cartilaginous tumor. However, when the biopsy came, I was shocked to see that it was a pyelomatrixoma. And pyelomatrixoma is a very common differential of small round blue cell tumor mimicker in pediatrics, but not a giant cell rich tumor in pediatrics. However, what I got was a lot of giant cells and an occasional splutter of small round blue cells. So, you know, that giant cell became a red herring for me. And then this paper was written and published. So my images are from Google, my publication is from the net as well as my own publication. So I hope this was of help, and I'll see you next time with a hematopath lecture. Thank you.